Ketiga, tahun yang ketiga kita ada meraikan Hari Malaysia. Kalau pimpinan, pucuk pimpinan Putrajaya, Barisan Nasional di Putrajaya boleh buat apa mereka suka buat, tentulah Hari Malaysia tidak akan menjadi hari cuti am, public holiday. Oleh kerana mereka tidak mahu mengiktirafkan betapa penting Hari Malaysia untuk negara. Mereka dipaksa oleh kuasa rakyat dan sebab itu mereka dipaksa untuk mengumumkan Hari Malaysia sebagai satu public holiday. Tetapi apa rakyat mahu bukan sahaja Hari Malaysia menjadi public holiday, kita mahu satu perubahan yang besar di Putrajaya yang boleh mengiktirafkan, mengakui hak-hak, tuntutan-tuntutan semua rakyat di Malaysia termasuk di Sarawak dan di Sabah. Itu yang apa yang rakyat mahu. We are here to celebrate Malaysia Day, the third anniversary. But if the Barisan Nasional government in Putrajaya wants to have their way, Malaysia Day will not be a public holiday. It took 47 years for Malaysia Day to be declared as a public holiday. This is because of people's power. People's power that has forced the BN to acknowledge the importance of Hari Malaysia. And it's because of two important factors. One is because of the very clear stand of Pakatan Rakyat, that when Pakatan Rakyat forms the government in Putrajaya, we will do what BN had failed to do, to declare Malaysia Day as a public holiday. So this has forced their hand. And secondly, because of the political tsunami of the 2008. In 2008, the Barisan Nasional suffered a severe thrashing. Pakatan Rakyat won 82 seats, BN won 140 seats, but 54 seats came from Sarawak and Sabah. If in the 2008 general elections, the 54 seats, parliamentary seats in Sarawak and Sabah had not saved Barisan Nasional, you have a reverse political demography in parliament. You will have Barisan Nasional in the opposition and Pakatan Rakyat in Putrajaya. There is not enough just to have the BN recognizing Malaysia Day as a public holiday if it is a half-hearted gesture. At present, Malaysia Day is only celebrated by BN in Sabah and Sarawak, not in the Peninsula Malaysia. Today, Pakatan Rakyat, Penaksi Government celebrated Malaysia Day. In 2008, the Selangor Pakatan Rakyat Government had a 20,000 rally for the countdown of Malaysia Day 2008. But as far as the Barisan Nasional is concerned, this is an event for Sabah and Sarawak. It is not a real national event. Secondly, if the Barisan Nasional finally is going to recognize the importance of Sabah and Sarawak, it must address, it must resolve the many long-standing, deep-seated grievances, unhappiness, frustrations, alienation of the people of Sarawak and Sabah, 49 years in Malaysia. Now, on the lips of the Prime Minister is the theme of Merdeka Day and Malaysia Day, janji ditepati. Adakah janji ditepati di Sarawak dan di Sabah? Adakah? Adakah janji ditepati di Sarawak di Sabah 49 tahun selepas Malaysia? Adakah? Sangat jelas tidak. And very clear that it is not the case. And that is why our proposal for a Royal Commission inquiry, I made that proposal in 2010 in Parliament for two consecutive years, that a Royal Commission inquiry should be set up to assess whether the dreams and aspirations of the people of Sarawak and Sabah, when Malaysia was formed 49 years ago, have been fulfilled or betrayed. And if janji ditepati is in fact the case, the Bahasa National Government would have jumped on the opportunity to showcase their achievements, to showcase what they have done, instead of running away from the issue. There is no doubt that in the last 49 years, instead of fulfilling the promises, the dreams of the people of Sarawak and Sabah when they formed Malaysia, the reverse had been the case. And in 1963, when Malaysia was formed, there was a Kobol Commission that conducted fact-finding missions, sought the views of the people on the question. And there were delegations organized and conducted for Sarawak and Sabah leaders to go to Peninsular Malaysia to see the development in Peninsular Malaysia. There were the promises that if Sarawak and Sabah joined and formed Malaysia, there will not only be constitutional safeguards as contained in the 20 points for Sabah and 18 points for Sarawak, but development for Sarawak and Sabah would be at par with Peninsular Malaysia. Are developments in Sarawak and Sabah at par with Peninsular Malaysia? Close to 50 years. If you have taken 10 years, 20 years, understandable. It is now close to half a century. Why is it that this greatest promise of developmental progress for Sarawak and Sabah have failed to materialize? And if we go quickly over some of the statistics, you will see how serious is this problem. The incidence of poverty overall for Sarawak and Sabah. Incidence of poverty overall, Sabah is the highest in the country, 19.7%. Sarawak is the third highest in the country, 5.3%. Equal with Kedah, Perlis is second at 6%. Number two, second criteria, incidence of rural poverty. Sabah is the highest in the country at 32.8%. Sarawak is the second highest at 8.4%. Gini coefficient, Sabah is the highest at 0.453. Sarawak is the second highest at 0.448. In fact, income inequality has increased in both states from 1999 to 2009. Sabah from 0.448 in 1999 to 0.453 in 2009, and Sarawak from 0.407 in 1999 to 0.448 in 2009. And finally, poverty line income, that is monthly income necessary to go above the poverty rate. Sabah is the highest at 1,048 ringgit. Sarawak is second highest at 912 ringgit. Peninsular Malaysia is 763 ringgit. As a result of 49 years of Sarawak and Sabah in Malaysia, there are four massive situations in Sarawak and Sabah. There is massive corruption. Correct? There is massive corruption. Number two, there is massive cronyism. Number three, there is massive landlessness. And number four, there is massive poverty in Sarawak and in Sabah. So, after nearly 50 years, the time has come for a proper assessment as to whether the dreams and aspirations of the people of Sarawak and Sabah have been fulfilled or betrayed, and that must be addressed. And I hope that when Parliament comes next week, and I propose to raise this matter for the third time, that the members of Parliament in Sarawak and Sabah, whether from BN or Pakatan Rakyat, and of course there's no problem, Pakatan Rakyat, from the Barisan Nasional, will give support for the establishment of a Royal Commission inquiry into 50 years of Sarawak and Sabah in Malaysia. You agree? Yeah. And because from my various visits to the interior of Sarawak and Sabah, it is very clear that widespread, deep-seated frustrations, disappointments among the people must be addressed. And I will say in Sarawak, the problems can be summed up in the four letters of CLIB. But in Sabah, you have an extra CLIBI. What is CLIB and CLIBI? C will be corruption. Prevalent in Sarawak, prevalent in Sabah, both states. Although the Prime Minister has said that fighting corruption is one of the key objectives of his government transformation program, NKRA, there is no doubt that corruption in Sarawak, corruption in Sabah tops the whole country. So corruption is a massive problem in these two states. L, landless, the problem of land, NCR, whether in Sarawak and Baru Bien, well known for its fighting cases of NCR, or in Sabah, whether for the Dayaks or for the Kadazan, Dusun Murid communities, land grievances has become from bad to worse. So that is something that must be resolved. Why is it these two states, which have the largest land acreage in the country, have the problem of land for the people who are generally in need in Sarawak and in Sabah? I, infrastructure, CLI, I, infrastructure, both in Sarawak and in Sabah. In the interior, we see the infrastructure backwardness. We see pipe water, a water pipe without water. We see electric, the poles without electricity. We see the people in Sarawak and Sabah lacking the most basic of health resources and educational facilities. Why should this be the case when these two states are so wealthy? B, Borneoization. The promise in particular, in which is specifically mentioned both in the 18 point of Sarawak and the 20 point of Sabah, the action will be taken immediately and quickly to carry out the process whereby the people of Sarawak and the people of Sabah will be able to take over the important position of the government services at the state and the federal level. That is not the case in Sarawak or in Sabah. And this has been highlighted by what the former Chief Justice Lord Tun Zaki has mentioned when he proposed that the recruitment, appointment into the civil service should be, the regulations should be reduced so as to encourage more Dayaks and ethnic minorities to be in these services. And it is very clear, this is not the case. This is not the issue. The issue is whether Borneoization takes place in these two states. And finally, for Sabah, as I said, there's an extra one, I, illegal immigrants. And up to now, although our Prime Minister Najib has announced a Royal Commission of Inquiry, RCIII, Royal Commission of Inquiry into Illegal Immigrants for Sabah, he took 6 months to announce the membership, 6 months to announce the terms of reference, but up to now, there is no sign that the RCIII has started work. And Najib has said, that the RCIII has been given 6 months to complete its report with effect from the official appointment of the members, and up to now, they have not been appointed. So I think this is what's important. Finally, the message that we must send out from our historic gathering here today is that the people want change, not only to bring about Malaysia Day as a public holiday, we want a change in Putrajaya, which can bring about a fundamental paradigm shift in nation building, where the people of Sarawak, the people of Sabah, the people of Malaysia can look forward to an equal place under the Malaysian sun. Thank you very much.
Yang Berhormat, Tuan Lim Kit Siang.